Whispers from the Brighter World, A Fifth Revelation. Beloved Master, Revered Babaji Maharaj, Friday, December 2nd, 2005, 10 a.m. Try as much as possible to remain serene in all circumstances. Has your heart not reached the shores of bliss and concluded in these places a holy pact under the best auspices? Set aside more moments for deep meditation, into which your soul excels in leading you and which makes you stronger when you again find your footing in the reality of this world. Put things into perspective, my child. Who better than you can manage to do so? Your access to the world of the spirit is significant in this aspect. Everything is relative here below, and it is not worth letting oneself to be taken in by this illusory game. For a seeker, each day must impel him to pursue his path. Each small victory over oneself has its own importance and well shows how effort can give benefits. It seems over time that everything must be started again, and yet the personality develops imperceptibly, yielding the best results. Each incarnate being is faced with the same battles. The most edifying ones are to be fought within oneself, in the secrecy of one's heart, where the best is shaped. Human nature unceasingly manifests itself, giving free rein to its inclinations. So many struggles and obstacles are to be surmounted to come out of them with increased stature. All our brothers and sisters experience it. So will it be until the end. This opportunity is given to men so that the best of them can prevail. From these battles, victory will emerge. The only one which is worth it in this long saga, signaling the destiny of every man. Our faithful and determined aspirants have understood where their priorities lie. They know that each day counts, and they live it in this spirit. Blessed are they in their constant efforts. Babuji.
Tantik, can you start recording? And we may go live on YouTube.
Sure, you may please go ahead, Brother Satish.
Okay. So thank you, everyone, for another opportunity to spend some time with you. Last week, the session was, to me, a very revealing one, because I found a lot of ways to make some changes in myself, especially after the session. So today we will be continuing from where we left off, And so I'll share my screen and we'll start from there. Hope you all can see the screen. Last week, what we did, we'll start off with a recap of that and then we'll take it further. Okay. What did we look at? We looked at point one and we looked at the four main sub points that were there, A, B, C, and D. We also looked at the importance of maintaining the purity of point one and what happens if we do, what happens if we don't, how it's going to affect the higher points as well. We looked at formation of samskaras and where the vibrations, the different vibrations that enter our system will be, you know, directed to where they settle. And we also looked at some cleaning techniques that help us secure the door at point C. And why? We saw that point C was the entry point. So we can stop it there if we can. And by doing that, we can maintain the purity of point A as well. And we also looked at the point, the importance and the technique of meditation at point A. We did a practical session. Today we look at B and D. We've covered A and C. We'll look at B and D, and then we will summarize the whole lot towards the end. And of course, take a few questions. Okay. We also looked at one particular aspect where we try to observe what is happening at point C, A, B, C, and D. When we observe it, when we are able to feel something, when we are able to experience something, we know which points are going to be affected or what emotions are causing what disturbance. And that helps us to actually adjust ourselves, to fix any errors that are there, any aberrations that may be there. We clean ourselves. We try to prevent things from happening. We can be proactive. The other important thing was the attitude of self-acceptance, because without self-acceptance, we will not be able to take it further. Okay. Very quickly, again, likes and dislikes, entering through point C, which is the landing point for impressions. Different emotions, different vibrations are there, and they go to the other points. Today, we are looking at point B, where sensuality and sexual desires and that sort of stuff will go to. And we'll be looking at guilt, which goes to point D. And we will explore this a little bit more today. Okay. So Lalaji Maharaj was very clear when he said, it's very important that we work on points A and B. And when Babuji found it, we saw this as well last week. But he also commented later that people are not practicing with proper attention that method which has been told about point B. So it was a categoric statement that people are not doing it. And he said, else they would have reaped a great benefit. And those who have taken up the practice would have derived the benefit as well. So it is so important that he had to repeat it again, you know, that people are not doing it and encouraging them to do it. So it's very important that we don't neglect this, as we will see what happens when we do this properly. In this session, when we conclude, we'll be able to see the whole picture. So working on point B, why do we clean point B? A few reasons. First, of course, like we know this, the desires, the sensual desires, those vibrations go to point B. So we need to get rid of them so that they don't disturb us anymore. They don't become obstacles to us. While we are doing this, managing the sensual desires, we also manage and balance the creative energy. Karma, karma is a God-given energy which is required. Why? Required for procreation, sustaining the human race. Karma is required, just like some of the others. Krodha, for example, anger. It is required as a corrective tool. It is God-given. The thing is, if we don't manage it, if we are not able to balance it, then it becomes a problem. So cleaning point B helps us to manage this creative energy called karma. As a passion detox, what happens when it's not managed? Then passion, in the wrong sense of the word, right? Vivekananda said, we need men of passion. He didn't mean in this context, if you know what I mean, right? Passion in a negative way, where the sexual passions are so high that it becomes a deterrent to spiritual progress. So the cleaning of point B is a technique we can use as a detox for this passion, to manage this detox, the passion. And of course, it also creates unity amongst all of us. Right? So the cleaning of point B has all these benefits. In combination with point A, which we saw last week, it helps us to expand our consciousness. Now, I put that in red because that is the primary result of this practice of point B in combination with point A, expanding our consciousness. So when do we do this? Before morning meditation. And again, only for 5 to 7 minutes. You don't overdo this as well. So these are some things. I mean, this part of it, before we do a morning meditation, somebody asked the question in one of the earlier sessions, do we do it before I brush my teeth? That is not the important point. You know, freshen yourself. Again, refer back to the maxims, you know, purity of body and mind. So when we are in that condition, freshen yourself, be alert. And then when we sit down and when we do this before we start our morning meditation, before we say the prayer for our morning meditation, we do 5 to 7 minutes of working on point B. Okay. So one more thing I wanted to do is, you know, all these have got a sankalpa behind it. The sankalpa, what was the sankalpa? We saw that a sankalpa is an intention with will, with love and prayer. All these coming together is sankalpa. If any one of those are missing, the effectiveness reduces. Okay. So when we do this point B when we do the cleaning, we have the sankalpa that something is happening. We must remember, sankalpa has to be very subtle. It's so subtle that it becomes a vibration. And it is so subtle that even the idea of having a sankalpa should be so minimal, but yet so potent. We do this connecting to Master, because without his help, we know that it is not going to work. And we need to prepare ourselves, fill our hearts with love, total faith, conviction. We saw this. We also saw how we can try and fill our hearts with love and invoke that condition in us and prepare ourselves to do the practice. Okay. So the cleaning of point B, what is the actual method? The method is fix your attention on point B and imagine all purity, impurities and heaviness. Right? Imagine that all impurities and heaviness are going out of point B from the front of the body. Okay, so we know that other cleaning that we do in the evening, it's through the back, but this one is through the front of the body from point B. And imagine that as this process is going on, the glow of the soul begins to appear from behind. So there are two aspects of this practice, and we will try it out as well very shortly. I'm not going to discuss the locations. I'm sure all of you know it. I'm sure all of you would have had a chance to revise it and check it out for yourself, where the points are A, B, C, and D. But we are now going to focus on point D. Okay. All right. So let us try and practice this. So I'll lead you through this. And I would request that we, like last time, we go through this process with an open mind, with a lot of conviction, a lot of faith that it is happening. Yes, we are supposed to do this in the morning, but we are just going to do this so we test it out for ourselves, and then we'll be able to do it once again tomorrow morning. Okay. So I request you all to settle down comfortably, relax, feel totally relaxed, and let's try this practice now. Okay. Sit comfortably and close your eyes. Very gently. Feel relaxed. Take a deep breath and let go. Now mentally locate point B in your heart region. Mentally locate the sternum, one finger below, and then four fingers to the left will help you to locate point B. Mentally do this. Having located it, connect your heart, establish the connection with the master, right? You've already located it. You don't need to go back again and again. You know where it is. Establish the connection with the master. Confirm the intention. What is the intention? That I want to remove all impurities and heaviness. That is my intention. Have the conviction that by the time we finish this, it would have been done. So establish this intention. So the sankalpa, as we know, is all impurities, lower tendencies, heaviness are all going out through the point B. And it is going out from the front of the body. So try to feel this, that all impurities and lower tendencies, heaviness, grossness, it's all going out through the front from point B. Try to create that prayerful state in your heart, you know, filled with love, filled with the connection to Master. It is only with this that the sankalpa is becoming more and more effective. Offer the suggestion, Master, my Lord, may all these be removed from my system. Do it as gently as you can. There is no force involved. feel all these are going out. And once that is established, gently, slowly intensify the process. Keep your attention on point B. Gently, but firmly push these out of your system through the front. Feel that area becoming lighter and purer. All the impurities and grossness are being pushed out. And it's becoming lighter. And just like a light bulb becomes brighter when the dust covering it is removed. Feel that the glow of the soul is appearing from behind, and as the cleaning is going on, this glow is becoming brighter and brighter. So the impurities are going out, and that glow from behind, the glow of the soul, is becoming brighter. We continue this for about 5 to 7 minutes. And when you feel settled and comfortable and light, very gently end the cleaning with a firm thought that it is completed, that the impurities and the grossness are removed. And the glow is nice and bright. It is glowing. The whole area is glowing now. Try to capture the emptiness, the subtlety of that inner condition. Normally, when you're doing this in the morning, you're in the perfect condition to offer the prayer, to connect, and to start the meditation, the morning meditation. But today, gently open your eyes. Try to savor that condition. Try to capture that condition. Take a minute or two to just write this in your diary. Try to compare it with what you've been doing and how you can improve it. What are the little nuances that you would have picked up from this? Please write it in your diary.
Brother Satish,
yeah.
There is a comment that they see black spots on the screen when you present. Next time when you present, you may want to just move the comment boxes a little away from the presentation area.
The comment boxes?
You know, the boxes that that belong to Zoom, right? They are showing as black on the screen.
Oh, I see. Oh, okay. Okay, let's... Can you tell me what you see? Okay. I don't know how to do this.
But you will see that there is a small arrow at the bottom. You see the share screen come to the little left. Yeah. Yeah. Click that. Click that. Yes. You click again, it will hide it on the top.
No, it's only taking it either up or down.
Oh, there is an option to hide it on the top. Okay. I think it's okay. It's not hiding the top portion now. You can leave it like that.
Is that
you can okay? Bring it down. You can
I'm
bring
just
it
trying
down.
To see if there's anything else here.
I think you have to close that.
Is this better?
You leave it like this. Yeah, this is okay. This is okay. This is fine, brother. We can go
sure?
on. Yeah,
okay.
Please. Yeah, go on.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. So this process that we saw today, very simple process, but a very, very powerful process. It is something very profound. And the more sincere you are, the more you do this with a lot of love and commitment, you will find the effect almost immediately. You will find the changes happening within you. But the important thing is, of course, as you must have done in your previous sessions, you need to identify the change, the condition, the change of your inner condition, and try to build on it. And the more you do that, the more you will be able to refine this whole process itself. So that's about point B, cleaning of point B. And everybody does it. Now let's look at point B now. Okay. I want to just start with this. Last week, we talked about this as well, the first part of when I was starting the session, how we need to excel ourselves in whatever we do. We need yesterday, today, tomorrow, when we compare ourselves. Today, we should be at least that much better than what I was yesterday. And tomorrow, I need to be better than what I am today. I need to be the best version of yourself. I need to keep working on it. You know, Taji talks about our yatra when you're traveling. We get glimpses during our meditation, during, you know, as we are doing our sadhana. We have glimpses of the reality of whatever that is, you know. But then we are able to identify that we are not what we think we are. Right? We may think something about ourselves, but we find that there's always a better version available, right? There's scope for me to become better. We are also in the process trying to see or becoming aware of the inner master within us. We see that inner master within us. And then from there, we are able to connect to the outer master, who's there, who's guiding us, who's helping us on this journey. And then what happens when we do this practice, when we refine this practice more and more, that master becomes like a mirror. And what do I mean by a mirror? He reflects in some way, in some beautiful way, what I am actually. So if I see the master as an angry person, if I start looking within myself, I can find that anger is there within me, which is being reflected there. So he becomes the mirror for me to compare and help me to improve myself. Right? So it is important that we develop this habit. Like if you see him as whatever, I mean, I don't want to give any qualities. You'll find that whatever you see there, when we are looking within myself, then I can see what I am. And once I know what I am, it is like looking in the mirror. There's no point in trying to change the mirror. That's not going to help. But seeing the defect in me, I'm able to change myself. Now, in this process, when we are doing this, we make mistakes. It is common, right? We are not perfect. None of us are perfect. To err is human, right? But the important thing is, to try to improve is also human. And that is where we need to focus on, right? So we need to understand, hey, there is something wrong here with me. There is something that I can do to correct myself. I have made a mistake. So what? Let me use this to correct myself. Let me recognize the fact that I have made a mistake. Let me repent for it. I don't want to make this mistake again and again. Making a mistake is not wrong, but making the same mistake again and again, definitely it is of concern. Right? Ask for forgiveness to that inner master, to the outer master, it doesn't matter. Preferably to that inner master who is there with you, your conscience, guiding you all the time, should we choose to listen. And then we decide that we will not make the same mistake again. And that is where we strive to improve. And unless we do that part of it, we are going to have some trouble. What happens? What happens if you don't? Right? Oops, sorry, I don't know what happened there. Can you see my screen? Yes?
Yes, I can see.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Sorry, I don't know. I must have clicked something down below here. Okay. Let's see how we can do this. What can we do to strive to improve ourselves? Okay. Now, I would like to touch on this aspect of the dynamics of guilt. What is guilt? Right? What is guilt? guilt is something, right, which arises within me. It is a feeling, isn't it? It is a deep-rooted feeling. It is a deep-rooted inner state. And how does that happen? It happens because of something that I know I should have done, but I did not do. Or I did something which I know I should not have done. It can happen both ways. And invariably, we end up doing it or not doing it. And then we start to find that it is bothering us. It is troubling us, irritating us. And it settles as guilt within us. It is very heavy because, you know, it's an awful feeling. It's a terrible feeling to have that sort of thing within us. You know, oh my God, I really wish I had done this. I really wish I had not done this. And that actually leads to guilt. And sometimes it is also leads to shame. It's a very tricky thing, you know, guilt and shame. We always talk about guilt when we talk about point D, but I would like you to consider this aspect also, this aspect of shame. Because guilt and shame are very, very closely related and have the equal sort of effect on point D. Very heavy, very difficult to remove. And guilt comes when we've been selfish, you know, like it's all about me. You know, I don't care what happens to others around me. That's all it is. I've been very selfish. Those actions invariably will end up in creating guilt within us. It happens when we take advantage of others. Obviously, when we are selfish, we take advantage of others. You know, self, you know, myself becomes so predominant. I don't care about the other people. It causes trouble. And this settles, you know, like when this enters our system, again, the landing point is point C. But then very quickly from there, it gets diverted and it goes and settles at point B, the lowest point there. And it is very, very hard to remove. Yeah. What happens is our hearts close. Our spiritual expansion is arrested. So spiritual growth is pretty much stopped. We can't go forward because this is literally pulling us down. It's not allowing us to rise. And it is like lead, you know, it is so heavy. It's destructive. It pulls us down very badly. And the unfortunate thing is it hides. It hides us, hides itself from the divine. I would like to just recollect that story that we talked about, Uddhava's story, you know, like Yudhishthira or Dharma, Dharmaraja as he was called. He knew he was doing wrong. He was trying to hide himself. He didn't want Krishna to know about it. You can see how he closed himself out. And we are locking the master out, the guide, the Lord. We are locking them out. How can they help us if we don't let them do it? You know, so we hide ourselves. We not only allow it to destroy us, we prevent any help from the higher self, from the master, from the Lord, you know, coming in to help us. We isolate ourselves. So it's so bad that it really doesn't allow us to go any further. So important that we understand this concept of guilt and shame. Okay. Now, how do these happen? Right? Daji has beautifully explained this. The types of wrongs that become it. He calls it the wrongs of omission. Omission is we omit doing things that we did not do. It can be because of fear, it can be because of selfishness, it can be due to can't be bothered, inertia, laziness, it could be any of those things. You know, like it is saying, you know, you see something wrong is happening and you say, I can't be bothered. And then you go back and say, really, I really wish I had done something. You know, somebody needs some help. I'm too selfish. I can't help. You know, I don't do it. Omission. Then Daji talks of that doctor's story. You must have heard it. You know, the example. Sorry, not a story, but an example where he says, you know, doctors on his rounds, and there's a patient who calls him and he says, "Doctor, I need your help. I'm in severe pain, blah, blah, whatever." And he says, okay, I'll come back to you. And he goes on with his rounds and then suddenly remembers, oh my God, that person needed my help. And by the time he goes there, that patient is gone. He was having a heart problem or something like that. And then this doctor feels guilty. If only I had attended to that person at that time, I could have got him on to the proper treatment, you know, to take care of his heart. And that is a wrong or an error or a mistake of omission. Then he talks of the wrongs of commission. Commission is when we do something intentionally, right? We hurt somebody. It could be physical, it could be verbal, it could be mental, it could be, you know, like we can torture somebody by our actions, by doing something. So these are wrongs of commission. We gossip, most dangerous thing that we do. We insult people, we spread rumors, we preach, you know, violence. We talk about, you know, all the wrong things. Those are called wrongs of commission. Yeah, and these are two very common things. Sometimes it is so, what did you call it? It's not very obvious, but we still do it. And we do it in such a soft way, you know, especially things like gossip and rumors and things like that. So easily we do it and then we feel bad about it. Sometimes we don't. That's the unfortunate other aspect of it. Sorry. It can be intentional or unintentional. We saw that. Right? Sometimes we do it intentionally to hurt. Sometimes we don't mean to, but it happens. You know, circumstances. Sometimes we don't even think about it. We are ignorant of other people. You know, like we don't value their cultures. We do something which we shouldn't be doing. And then we feel bad. Mistakes based on misunderstanding. Daji again talks about this, you know, like just a simple misunderstanding. You know, there is a meeting at 9 o'clock, right? And I tell somebody, no, it's at 10 o'clock. That person believes me, and both of us, you know, it's just a misunderstanding. It's a wrong thing. And at 10 o'clock, we go for the meeting and we find we are too late. It's a mistake. And now I was the one who said it, and I feel bad about it, right? We don't even foresee what the consequence is going to be. We were a bit careless. Some mistakes are very genuine, right? Sometimes they are not. You know, like you make a genuine mistake. It can happen. I'm not able to give you an example, but we know what I'm talking about. Genuinely, I really didn't know that I was doing something which I should not have done, or I did not do something which people expected me to do. It's a genuine mistake. But again, all these start to create some vibration, some feeling within us. Sometimes it's a one-off thing. You make a mistake and you feel sorry and you move on. Sometimes habitually we keep making the same mistake again and again. That is something that we need to work upon. So types of wrongs are plenty. And when we look at it, when we look at ourselves, we find that there are a lot of areas where we can correct ourselves, where we can improve. And unless we do that, we will not be able to overcome this issue. So guilt and shame, I touched upon shame aspect of it, but you know, mental patterns, we've talked about this. I just want to bring in these words, kleshas and sorry, the kleshas and the vikshepas, right? mental patterns, habits, are called kleshas. When they become hardened, why I'm saying this is, in this article that Daji has written in the Heartfulness magazine, which I strongly encourage you all to read, he's explained it very, very nicely. These mental patterns become hardened and they become obstacles. And Patanjali identified 9 vikshepas. But Daji said there are 3 more. And one of them is vikshepa of shame and guilt. A vikshepa is a very, very strong obstacle in the path of our spiritual progress. Right? And shame and guilt will both lodge at point D. So this was in the 2019 collector's edition. If you've not read it, please, please read it. It is really something useful for us. Okay, so this vikshepa of shame and guilt is something that we need to address, because that is going to be a real barrier in our progress. Now just imagine, sometimes this shame is such a dangerous thing. Now, sometimes the shame can be because of our actions, but sometimes the shame can be the result of someone else's behavior towards us, right? And Daji explains this. He says, just imagine a victim of child abuse, how hard it is going to be. They don't know, you know, like they feel so ashamed. So they feel guilty, they feel ashamed. That sort of thing is so hard to get rid of, you know. This shame because of our actions, or the shame because of someone else's actions, which are bothering us, is very, very hard to remove. And there's no easy way out of it. But the other interesting thing is, I've heard this, and sometimes I've felt it myself too. I don't feel guilty. Like, I didn't do anything today, or I didn't shy away from doing anything today. I don't feel guilty. You know, it's a funny feeling. Daji says, congratulations, you must be a saint. And that immediately it starts, you know, pointing the finger at me. Hey, are you a saint? What's going on? Even a saint finds room for improvement. You know, it is so important. We need to understand this. Are we so spotless? Are we so guilt-free? When we start looking within, when we scan ourselves, we can find out where I can improve myself. There are so many things which I could have done today. Did I do it? Let me correct it. Now, when I start looking at it from that perspective, that's when the whole progress starts from within me. You know, at that stage, when I start looking and when I say, I don't have any obvious reasons to feel guilty, now I start probing within myself. And when I probe within myself, there are small matters, which so far I thought was so insignificant, but when I start looking at it more and more, I find even these smaller things can now start to be corrected. So we are going deeper and fine-tuning whatever we can do to become better. So this idea of fine-tuning needs to start to work on us, because it's easy to take care of the larger ones, but the smaller ones are the ones that are still sitting there. And at some stage, they will also start to bother us. So scan your heart, see where your conscience is pricking you. Perhaps I didn't do my sadhana properly. I didn't meditate properly. Can that trigger a little bit of guilt within me? I told my fellow abhyasi that you have to do this, but I haven't done it myself. Is that creating a little bit of a shame within me that I am not being true to myself and true to my master? Is that causing some trouble within me? Start somewhere. we will find that there is room for improvement again at every stage. And we need to work on it. Find out the reason why, what is going on, why is it that this happened? And when we do that, and when we are able to nail it down, we know what is the next step. We know how we can fix it. Daji says, without such introspection, there is no possibility of improvement. So it is a constant work in progress. We need to work upon ourselves. We need to have the intention, I must become better. I need to do this. I need to get rid of this guilt. I need to keep my point D clean and pure. And when I start working on that, then the effect is going to be definitely in the right direction. Okay. Now, how do we remove guilt and shame? We need self-compassion. Number one, be forgiving to yourself. Have compassion. Don't punish yourself. There's no need for that. Self-acceptance. I need to accept, yes, I do make mistakes. I too am imperfect. And I need to have the courage to own up. I need to have the courage to face the mistake and the courage to stand up and say, yes, I did it and I'm going to fix it. We need to open up. This opening up is a very important thing. Because if we don't open up, then we are trying to hide it. We are trying to cover it up. We won't let go of it. We are holding on to it. And that is not going to help us. Now, do we need to remember everything that we have done or not done? It becomes a very mammoth task. You know, sometimes we remember it, sometimes we don't. But, you know, if we try to only recollect it, sometimes we start to only reinforce it. We don't need to do that. All we need to remember is when we open up, when we allow ourselves to be, you know, ready, we have surrendered to the master and saying, Master, yes, I need to do this. I need to become better. Please help me. And when I have that attitude, whatever needs to come out will be coming out. And at that stage, you can even be sure that his help is there to help you to remove it, to get it removed from you. And when we meditate with transmission and practice the cleaning, this guilt, this shame will surface. It will start to come out. And in the process, it starts, the process has started to get it removed, get it out of our system. And of course, the help of a guide is beyond value. You can't say how important it is. It is so very crucial that when the right attitude is there, the help is there, and that help is the best you can ever have to get all this out of our system. So how do we remove this? What can we do about it? And that is exactly what we call the process of repentance, working on point D, removing this from our system. It is the process of repentance. And what is repentance? We will see what that is. But before that, guilt is so heavy. Guilt because of something that we did knowingly, even God cannot clean that guilt from us. Only we can do it. Master will not do it. It can be done by the Abhyasi through his tears of repentance. Right? Oh my God, I did this. Oh, I should not have done this. I really feel bad about it. I repent for it. I really feel that it was a wrong thing and I will not repeat it. So all this repentance and resolution that you won't repeat it and the tears to cry your heart out is worth 1,000 prayers for forgiveness. Really, it is an open-hearted cry from within. Tears are the sign of sincerity. Not crocodile tears, not artificial tears, but really, when you feel it, I shouldn't have done it. And you really weep for it. We have to face the guilt and expose ourselves, becoming naked from inside. So it is an attitude. It is a change that is happening within me because I understand that I need to get rid of it. I feel that, I know that I should not have done this. And the worst part is I did it intentionally. And that is so bad, so unlike what it should be. And that needs to go only by this repentance. And when we open ourselves, when we repent, our master will remove what he has to remove. When we meditate with the transmission, guilt will surface. I mean, we saw that in the last slide. How does it happen? Because our master is creating a vacuum in our system and he's pulling the complexities. He helps to remove it. He cleans. He does the deeper cleaning from within us. You must have heard this before, how when you do your own cleaning, you are doing one level, the first level of cleaning. When you take a sitting with a preceptor, you're going and getting some deeper stuff removed from you. And when you're taking a sitting from the master, when the master is working on you, he is removing some of the deepest levels of complexities from within us. So this process of repentance works in conjunction with our own sadhana to help to remove the deep impurities of guilt and shame from within us. And the best time to do this is at bedtime. Just before sleeping at night would be the best time that you would do this process of repentance and the purification of point D, if you want to call it that. There are five major steps involved in this. In this process of repentance, there are five steps. And what are they? The entire process is done while prayerfully connecting with the center through the heart. We need to connect to the master. When I say center, we are talking of the master, we are talking of the Lord, the inner master, whatever. I mean, you can use your own words, but unless you are centered, unless you are in that state of mind where you are very nicely connected with the inner master, this process can just become a ritual, which we should not allow. We should not allow this to happen. So prayerfully connecting to master within us, we go through this process of repentance, which consists of five steps. The first thing is to recognize that I made a mistake, to recognize that I did something or I did not do something, right? Which we talked about a bit earlier. Take responsibility. Yes, it is my responsibility. I did not do it. You know, when I take responsibility, it sort of starts the ball rolling, as you can say, to get this out of my system. I mean, okay, I recognize I made a mistake, but you know, I have my own reason. It's not really. I don't think it's my responsibility. When you come up with excuses, when you come up with reasons, trying to justify yourself, you're putting a block there. So the second step is stop. So when you take responsibility, you take ownership of that, you are on the right track. The third one is remorse. I feel bad about it, right? I regret it. I should not have done this. And this regret is not, again, a superficial one. It is something which is coming from within. I really feel remorse. I really feel bad that I should not, or I should have, whatever it is, right? And when that happens, when I feel that remorse coming from deep within me, when I feel sincerely, you know, regretful of whatever has happened, my heart is now starting to melt. At that stage, what I can do is request for forgiveness. Again, at this stage, what is happening is things like humility start to come, you know, to bloom within us, really, because now I'm trying to surrender my ego, accepting a mistake, feeling bad, and I'm requesting forgiveness, right? I'm transcending my ego now. And finally, I resolve not to repeat this again, right? Now that resolution is also very important, because there's no point in doing all this if I'm going out and doing the same thing again at the next opportunity. It's not going to help me. So recognize, accept responsibility, feel the regret, feel the remorse, request forgiveness, beg the master for forgiveness, right? And resolve not to repeat it again. These five steps are the most important, crucial aspects of repentance. Okay. Having understood this, I would like you to just quickly recollect Maxim 10 and the prayer, because that will be the part of this whole process. So at bedtime, this is Maxim 10, at bedtime, feeling the presence of God, repent for any wrongs committed unknowingly. Knowingly is very hard. I mean, it's so hard. Unknowingly, yes, you can do it. But knowingly, it requires something much more, you know, the tears that we talked about. At bedtime, feeling the presence of God, repent for any wrongs committed unknowingly. Beg forgiveness in a supplicant mood. Prayerfully resolve not to allow repetition of the same. And of course, we know the prayer, right? I'm not going through that now. We all know it. O Master, thou art the real good of human life. We are yet but slaves of wishes, putting bar to our advancement. Thou art the only God in power to bring us up to that stage. We know the prayer. Okay, so let's practice this. Again, we'll go through a very quick, we won't do the entire 15 minutes of it. We'll just do it very briefly, just to give you a taste of it. And let's see where that takes us. So once again, please settle down. Please sit comfortably, close your eyes, and relax. Bring your attention to your heart. Feel that it is being filled with love. Connect to Master. Feel that connection stronger, growing stronger and stronger. Invoke his presence. Very prayerfully. Allow this presence to expand. Allow it to grow within you. Feel you're totally in osmosis with him. You're totally immersed in that connection. Scan your heart. Very gently. See where your conscience is troubling you, where it is pricking you. What is making you feel uncomfortable? Why is that so? What is the reason behind it? Just in a very soft way. Be compassionate. Be self-accepting. But have the idea that I'm doing it. I need to do this. It is important. Once you've identified this, you go through the process again of accepting the responsibility. Yes, I made a mistake. Feel the remorse. I should not have done this, Master. I made a mistake. Feel the remorse. Really start, allow that feeling to come out from within you. Ask for forgiveness, Master. I'm sorry. I've created this mess within me. I'm really sorry, Master. Please forgive me. Please help me to remove this. I will not do this again. It's a resolution now. It is a process. Remember the 5 R's that we talked about. Recognizing that you made a mistake. Accepting the responsibility. Regret, remorse is the 3rd step. Repentance, ask for forgiveness. And then resolve that I will not do it again. Look at it in a very positive way. It is not to punish myself, but I'm being compassionate. I'm helping myself by accepting it. But being compassionate to myself, but at the same time correcting myself. When we are able to do this sincerely, we can allow the heart, you know, feel the heart starting to melt. The tears will come from our eyes. Don't be too concerned if you are not able to pick on any particular aspect. But there are so many things which are hidden within us. Sometimes we are not even aware that is there, but it is holding us down. It will surface at some time. But let it go. Yeah, Master, if there is something like that, please, Master, help me to remove it. Stay in the state of repentance, of total acceptance. Just remain like that for a minute or two. Reconfirm, resolve that you will not repeat it again. Very heartfully, very sincerely. And in this state of surrender, in the state of self-acceptance, having made the resolution, mentally repeat the prayer slowly. O Master, Thou art the real goal of human life. We are yet but slaves of wishes, putting bar to our advancement. Thou art the only God and power to bring us up to that stage. Go beyond the words into the feeling that comes with it. Allow the words to resonate in the vacuum in your heart. Allow that feeling to expand. Allow that feeling to grow. From the words to the feeling, into a very prayerful state. Feel the subtlety of that inner condition again. Normally you would do this at bedtime and you would be getting ready to go to sleep. But once again today, we'll do differently. But just to add one more, before you go to sleep, when you do it tonight, have this idea to the higher self, to the inner self, to Master. I'm eagerly looking forward, Master, to meet you again tomorrow morning in my meditation. Allow that feeling to sink into yourself in that prayerful state. Try it before you go to bed tonight. But now, like we did last time, very gently open your eyes. Try to capture that inner condition and write it in your diary. Try to note the nuances, changes, small modifications that you can do from what you've been doing before. Try to note it down in your diary. Okay. So what can we do about this? Avoiding formation of guilt, right? It's good to clean stuff and remove stuff that is already there, but the best step would be to prevent it from happening, isn't it? So can we do that? What can we do to prevent formation of guilt? Avoid such situations. What situations? Situations that can cause guilt to be formed in us, right? How do you do that? You know, classic examples, you know, we know that certain situations are going to cause trouble. Avoid those. You know, one of the things that we talk about is peer pressure, isn't it? Students, youngsters, they're all trapped in that. Avoid it. You know, you can, some of these games, I forget the name of that game now, youngsters have committed suicide playing those dangerous games. Avoid situations. If you know that something is going to create it, and our conscience is always there telling us, hey, watch out, this is not going to help you. Avoid those situations. Avoid taking advantage of another person's situation, exploitation, selfishness, things like that. You know, like that person is in a weak position, stamp him out, you know, or exploit him. So do that. Avoiding that selfishness part. You know, the idea of I to we, developing brotherhood. How can we develop brotherhood? We talked about that earlier. We talked about point A, the meditation on point A. Once we develop that brotherhood, how can I become selfish? You'll start to see slowly that it is all getting linked to each other. Right? Constant remembrance. How does this help? Think about it. We talked about the Uddhava story. When the Lord is by my side all the time, how can I do something wrong? How can I do something that is going to make me feel guilty? You know, so remembrance. When I know my master is with me, he's watching over me, he's guiding me. Now, if I choose to cut him out or push him away, I'm only getting myself into a situation that is going to lead to guilt. So think about it. It's so important, because unless we are able to bring it all together and understand how it all works to help us, we are still going to be going round and round in circles. How can we all do this? Prayerful alertness to the signals that emanate from your heart and guide us from within. I'm talking about that inner conscience, right? Do we listen to it? That little voice that tells us to do something or not to do something, which we tend to ignore depending on circumstances, unfortunately. Okay, so having covered all this, we'll now look at some important points before we wind up regarding Maxim 10, which is again, you know, offering the prayer, repentance, so the whole lot, all right? Some points which I would like you to really focus on. I would like you to introspect on some of these. Make a note of it if you want to, but try to understand the impact of it, because that's what is going to take us forward. When we introspect, if I introspect thinking I will correct myself, I know what happens there, it is my ego that is talking, right? And that's not going to take me anywhere. It cannot work. What is needed is a mixture of introspection. Yes, I need to correct myself, but I need to surrender. I need to request, you know, like, okay, there's only so much I can do, but this is something far beyond what I alone can do. I need my master's help there. Relinquish yourself, invoke the higher help. When that help comes, and when I'm surrendered, when I'm willing to accept that help, and I have the intention to make the change, to correct myself, that's when the beauty happens. The real essence of Maxim 10 is feeling the presence of God. Now, if we don't feel the presence of God, it becomes a ritual. It just becomes something that you would do. You wouldn't think twice about it. Just do it and get on with it. Feel the presence of the Lord, right? unless when we recognize that presence, we will see our ego. And it is, you know, we'll see the insignificance of that ego. Because unless we see that insignificance of that ego, the ego will try to dominate and pull us down, literally. You know, so prayerfully, when we are drooping down, literally, in that state of surrender, and then making these resolutions, that's when the work can happen. Another interesting thing is at bedtime, we're often too sleepy to rouse that feeling, to bring about that feeling. So the Aji says, we can practice offering the prayer during the day when we are still alert. So when you're alert, when all your, you know, every part of you is very alert to do what you want to do, you can do this. Create that feeling in while you're alert. Then what happens when you, he says, he doesn't say, okay, if you've done it, then don't do it at bedtime. No, he doesn't say that. He says, when you offer it again at bedtime, the very act of praying will revive your earlier state. So it's a very interesting aspect, which I would like you all to consider. Offer the prayer when you're alert. And then when you try to capture the essence of it, rouse that feeling of prayerfulness within you, that prayerful state within you. And then when you offer it at bedtime, even though you are sleepy, even though you are tired, you are ready to crash, that condition can revive in you and help you get into the right state before falling asleep. Okay, so that's regarding maxim 10, some points which you can make note of. Some more points. There are about 4 slides, I think, where I'm going to give you some ideas of something for you to introspect on and to build on it, to develop it and take it further. It is all to do with A, B, C, and D, right? Okay, the first one, this is regarding A and B, points A and B, the practice of points A and B. Chariji says, this is for the sincere seeker who, being aware of the tendencies of his mind and who, deploring his own activities in the field of action, wishes to correct himself sincerely, honestly, you know, towards correcting himself and divinizing himself eventually. He says, you know, people who are perverted, who don't want to change their tendencies, their habits, their, you know, whatever they are doing, their wrongdoings, for them, this technique will not work because the willingness is not there, right? They don't want to correct it. They don't see anything wrong with it. For such people, this A and B technique is not going to work. So it is something which we need to bring about in within us, the sincerity with which you want to do this. I am aware that I have this tendency of the mind. I need to correct myself. The degree of the tendency can vary, but the tendency can be there, and I want to correct myself. Right. So that is number one. Then the second point is, why is it different for sisters? Again, Chariji, in his talks to the preceptors, he said this. I think this is necessary in the case of women because, as you know, they are propagators of the race, right? So that is why the system is different for women. Women have a greater responsibility in the propagation of the human race. And that is why she thinks divine blessings are coming to her. And why? The tendency to celibacy is not taken too far. Just imagine if all men and women completely give up or get rid of their sensual feelings. That is also, you should remember, that process is also required. The sensual process, the sexual attraction, the sexual feelings are required to a certain extent for the propagation of the human race. And as Daji says, which is the next one, God was not a fool to create 2 sexes. But just as celibacy is not the natural state, at the other end, extreme passion can also get out of hand and end up in sex addiction or perversion. So this creative energy needs to be managed and balanced. So, with the sisters, they have a greater responsibility, and that is the reason why they have a slightly different way of doing the meditation on pointing. So, some point, something that we need to be aware of. Okay. Next one. Point A meditation and point B cleaning help to remove heavier tendencies in our life. We've seen that. By practicing them daily, you will contribute in two ways. One is your own purification, as well as to the greater good. How do you think it will result in the greater good of others around us? What happens if everybody were to think that they are brothers and sisters? Just apply it to today's situation. See what is happening around the world, right? You can see so many things that are happening where there is no consideration of what is for the others. Do you think that will happen if we understand that they are brothers and sisters? Now, the A and B practices are not two different practices. They are tightly integrated with our daily practice, right? Because when we do point A meditation and it becomes reality, point B cleaning becomes so simple. Because we are accepting others as brothers and sisters. The pervert tendencies will not arise. The light of the soul is always shining, right? And the witness is present. The witness, the soul, the light of the soul is that inner master there, right? It means the presence of the master is constantly perceived. So nothing will settle at point C. And in such a case, can we do anything that can create guilt? It's not going to happen. They're all tied together. They're so beautiful, integrated. Imagine the harmony that would result in human societies if people around the world practiced it daily. Right? Okay. Nearly there. Again, A and B practice is not just about passion, it's all about super consciousness. To remove passion is a very limited view. Once you remove passion, points A and B expand limitlessly. Daji talks about it. And how? Because of desires, passion, which are concentrated at A and B, they work like a black hole with tremendous vacuum power. You know what is a black hole? It pulls everything around it. Even our consciousness is just pulled into that. Once you release those desires and release those passions, absolute expansion happens as a natural consequence. And that is why we do cleaning of point B and meditation at point A. It is not because of passion. The main thing is super consciousness. Another point. This was again about likes and dislikes. I wanted to very quickly touch on this. Please understand, says Daji, I am not saying that wealth, power, popularity, knowledge, fame, passion, or status are wrong. It is only when the ego attaches its identity to them that things go wrong. Try to introspect on this, please. At the root of all wrongdoings is this false sense of identification, the primary misunderstanding of who we really are. So it is only when the ego attaches its identity to everything, to whether it's wealth or power or popularity, whatever it is, that's when the problem starts. With detachment, again, this is talking about detachment, the wrong concept of detachment that people carry. When you want to run away from so many things, you become an escapist, right? And what happens? What is escapism? That will actually restrain your heart. You know, you don't want to become like that. You don't want to become an escapist. You know, where will you escape? And Daji asked this question. Even if you escape, what are you escaping to? You know, the idea of escapism doesn't work at all. And he says, just change your idea of attachment. Think of attachment in the sense of loving your family, then expanding that true love. The other day, when we talked about love, we were talking about, you know, like, think of that love that is there, that you felt somewhere, and then expand it. And expand it to include your family, everything around you, all our friends, relatives, and so on, and expand it as far as you can. Right? Now, that kind of attachment is not the attachment that is pulling you down. Right? It is an expanded state. With a restrained heart, when you try to escape, you cannot have this expansion. Right? Attachment can also mean to love someone without any expectations. You don't have to be selfish or possessive. Right? Would you like to call this non-attached attachment? Think about it. So finally, our practice, our sadhana must not become a chore. It should not become tedious. It should not become boring. It should be something that you look forward to. And what am I talking about? What can make it come alive and develop vibrancy? It is attitude and interest. And the practice itself, if you remember what Daji has said, 5% is only the practice. 95% is attitude. Attitude and interest. Increase the force of this intensity or the craving. It is different from effort. It's all about attitude, right? It's a special attitude. And when that attitude develops, when I realize that it is for me to become better, it is for my brothers and sisters. We are in it together. You know, we all need to grow together. It is a change of attitude, a change of approach within us that is going to take us further. Create fascination, passion, and restlessness towards the practice. The key to success is action, perseverance, and surrender. And perseverance and surrender are automatic when there is love. So, the simple formula: meditate, retain, and grow. Take one step at a time. Retain is A-E-I-O-U. Practice first, and everything will follow, provided the right attitude is there. We need to walk with faith in our abilities, our own belief, and our own trust and confidence. Invoke those things. And when we do our part well, the guide is able to do his so much better. Remember, if we don't cooperate, the guide cannot do anything. He cannot. His hands are tied. So when we do our part, the guide is able to help us. Our master is able to help us. And therefore, all I can say, let us practice like never before. Thank you very much. I know I have overshot the time a little bit today, but when I prepared for this, I was hoping, I was trying to finish it by 7 o'clock. But some of these, you don't get an opportunity to share if we try to limit it, you know, and somehow rush through it. So I just thought, let me just allow Master to take over and do what needs to be done. I did speed up a little bit, but I'm sorry if I've disrupted anyone. You know, your evening, Sunday evening programs, but yeah. Hopefully there is some takeaway for all of you from this. Thank you very much. I'm happy to take any questions if someone, if you're okay to stay back for a little longer, but I leave it to you, the organizers.
Sister Manisha, you would like to go with the questions?
Thank you so much, brother. Thank you for this enriching and insightful session today. While I was listening to you, towards the end, I was also going through the questions which were given by the viewers, and I also had some of mine. But I realized after listening to your talk, it seems that each question was already sent to you, I don't know, somehow by Master's grace. But I actually looked at each and every question, and the way you have done your presentation, each question was answered. So I hope and I feel that all the viewers who have raised the questions last session or even this session they had some, I feel that their questions have been answered very clearly by brother. I also ask Sister Jogesh if she feels there is anything which is important. Because I can also see that it's already 7 p.m. And we have passed time. Thank you so much, all the viewers, and Brother Satish again.
Thank you for the opportunity. So, if there are no questions, then we can wind up. Is that okay? I don't know.
Sister Jogesh and Brother Ramesh, you can have a look again if there is anything. There were questions, but it seems every question has been answered.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, brother.
All right. Thank you very much.
And, giving us such detailed explanations and also better understanding on how to practice point A, B, C, and avoid.
But there's someone asking a question.
I don't know.
Harihar Lakshman.
Hello, brother. Thank you so much. This is Harihar from Singapore.
Yes, brother, go ahead.
Brother, thank you so much for your wonderful session. Just one very quick question, brother, if I can.
Yeah.
This question has been there with me and I've been able to find the answer. Point B, we do the cleaning. And we generally give the suggestion that all these impurities are going from the front.
Yes.
Any particular reason why it is from the front, while all the other practices are either from the back or from the side?
It's a very tricky one. And honestly, I can only come up with my own answers for it. But to me, the simple reason is, Babuji, when he discovered this practice, when he came up with this concept of A point meditation and B point cleaning, when that was revealed to him, from his experience, he found that is the best way to do it. That is the only answer that I can really give you. Anything else I'll be trying to give you is an interpretation, which I really don't want to, start to give in this. So from his experience, that's seems to be most straight, you know, the most effective way, right? And I don't have any other answer for this, brother. I'm sorry. It's one of those questions where, you know, like we can try. I mean, like Daji says, you know, some of these things you try. Try to do it the other way and see if that's going to be more effective. But, you know, it is, I mean, don't say Satish said you can try. That's not what I'm trying to say. But, you know, a lot of these things by his experience, by his own, you know, revelations that he's had, he found that this is the way to do it. Okay. I've heard explanations. I've heard a few other people give some different explanations to it, which, I mean, on a forum like this, I don't think it's proper for me to share because there is no authentic reference which I can give for that. You know, so I wouldn't like to share it in a forum like this, right? I have been asked this question. I've tried to go through the literature to find something, but there is no other reason. So for me, the only reason at this stage is Babuji's guidance is do it this way. Sorry, brother, I'm not able to.
No, brother, I think that's a wonderful answer. In fact, brother, because I have also gone through whatever little bit of literature, it did not, you know, give me that answer as well. So yes. Since you very extensively covered this, I just thought, you know, if you have more insight.
No.
But thank you so much, brother, for your openness. Thank you.
I've heard explanations. I've heard people give some reasons, but they're personal interpretations, which in a forum like this, I don't think it's appropriate to share.
Thanks, brother.
Okay. Okay. Any other question?
So
go ahead.
There's a quick one again, brother.
Yes.
Although you have taken us through a very wonderful process of doing point A and point B meditation practically in today's session and last session, which was wonderful and very impactful within those 5-10 minutes. But in case an abhyasi is not able to locate exact position of those points, although we know it theoretically, we have seen the pictures, are there any implications of not knowing the correct positions?
Okay. It's one of those things. I mean, we need to understand what is a point, what is, you know, how do we define a point, right? There are two parts to this I would like to share. One is, if we read Babuji's works in Towards Infinity and Daji's explanations on all this, when you say a point, it's not like a geometric point, right? Even when he says it's a point, he talks of it as something much bigger than that, right? So trying to say it is a particular point and I'm going to measure, you know, from the sternum. Now, the moment I pick my sternum, am I picking a point on the sternum or somewhere along the sternum, thickness of my finger? I mean, when we try to go pedantic on this, we get lost. Okay. Now, one finger down from the sternum, four fingers towards the left, you get to point B, right? Trying to pick that point B as a point is extremely difficult. So mentally, even physically doing it, every time you do it, you may find it's something different. Now, so once we have the concept that that is where the point is, we can start working on it. Now, when we have a specific vibration, if we are able to try to locate that vibration in that area, it will sort of tally with the measurements that you have had. Say you're having a passion vibration, a sexual passion vibration. See where it is trying to affect you at that time, if you can. See if it tallies with this idea of one finger, four fingers, and point B. If you are able to correlate it, you can start to try and get a better location of that point for you to get clarity. So that is one aspect of it. Let us look at it from a different perspective. You know, like suppose I pick a map and say Kuala Lumpur, right? It is a point on a map, isn't it? But that is not Kuala Lumpur. It is something which will help me to locate where Kuala Lumpur is. But when I get to KL, I am not in a point. I am into a different dimension, a different state of vibration. Physically speaking, KL is not a dot anymore. KL is something much bigger. So in a spiritual yatra, when I try to do that and I'm getting into that point, I'm actually expanding into a totally different level of consciousness, a different dimension, if you want to call it that way. Okay, so even if I'm not able to exactly pinpoint the location when I'm doing point B cleaning, when I work with that intention and that concept and get to that location and then go deeper inside, I'm into a dimension which is different. And it is at that level that I'm doing my cleaning. And when I do it that way, it's going to work. So trying to be pedantic and trying to pinpoint and say, oh, I'm not able to locate point B, it only makes you feel very technically uncomfortable, but it's not taking you beyond that. Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you so much for that.
So have the concept, it is an indication, that's where it is. And get there and get into that dimension, get into that feeling, that get into that level of vibration and see how it works. Okay. Yes, Sister Kalarani.
Hello, brother. Just was talking about this dimension. I think it's just like how we try to find the light within us, the immediate light within us. So there's not an exact point where it is. We just feel that it is there and we do it. So I think point B also, we just realize it is there, the point B,
yes,
roughly where it is, and then we just do it with faith, yes, that master will
discover. Yes. When the right intention and the right connection is there, all these minor things will take care of themselves and the work happens.
Okay. So, just want to clarify.
Yeah. Thank you, sister. Yes.
Okay.
There was another question about some prarabdha karma or something. Do you remember what that was?
Yes, brother. There was one question.
Yeah.
And it was like we are born with prarabdha karma.
Yes.
And
yes,
we add on to that in our present birth. And correct, on top of that, we have some sanchit karma also.
Yes.
So then how is it possible for master to get rid of all those karmas when we have okay, so much burden?
Okay, I don't know whether I answered it or not. I think perhaps I did during the session itself, you know, like, what happens is we are born on this earth with a load of karma, right? Which you call prarabdha karma, right? And our process is to wipe it out. Although the bank is there with still some, you know, leftovers there, which I have not cleared so far. This life, I've come down with only so much. That is still remaining up there, wherever that is. Now, in the process of clearing this, unfortunately, while this is being bhogged, you know, undergoing bhog, I'm inviting more and creating more, which also adds to my current, you know, stock of karma. Now, this current stock of karma, when I leave this body, whatever is not exhausted goes back and gets added to the other one. We know that. Okay. In our system, when we do this cleaning process, right, our day-to-day stuff, accumulation of karma that is coming in, number one is cleaned off if we are doing our cleaning properly. If we do spot cleaning, we do, you know, prevention properly, you know how we can avoid formation of samskaras. In the process, we are also undergoing some of them as bhog, as suffering, you know, good or bad karma, suffering or enjoyment, whatever you choose to call it. We go through that and we clear that. So that is also happening. Now, when we take a sitting with the preceptor, we talked about, I think I did mention it during the session, some deeper levels of karma are also being cleaned out. But when the master is working on us and we are cooperating with master, please underline the word cooperating with master. When we are permitting him, when we have surrendered to him and we are letting him, please master, help me. When we are able to do that, he is able to access the deeper ones, which perhaps is what is the store on top in the other dimension, wherever that is. And he is able to access that and clear that too. Right? And obviously, we have to undergo certain things. He is not going to be able to remove everything. If all those karmas, all those samskaras are removed in one shot, I don't have any physical existence anymore. I'm gone. I'll move away from into the next dimension. So there are certain things that we have to undergo. Certain things we cleanse, we work with the preceptor who cleans and the master. And when that happens, that is when he is able to clear all this and move us into the next dimension, into the next region, from the Pind Pradesh, from the heart region on to the next Brahmand and so on and so forth. Okay, but please underline the word of cooperating with master, surrendering to master, because without that, it is not going to work. And he cannot. Daji actually even says, you know, like if a master tries to interfere in that without our willingness and our surrender, it can amount to something like spiritual rape, which is not going to happen. So it's very important that we are able to surrender to him and allow him to help us. The same, again, we can relate back to that Uddhava story and where Krishna is tied, you know, when Draupadi is going through that, Vastraharan, he couldn't do anything. Initially, she was hoping that her husband, one of the Pandavas would help, or one of the people in the audience, in the sabha there would help. Finally, she had to, when she called him, he said, Krishna, where are you? Please, I need your help. And there came the help. And he was able to come in and do what. So when we are able to understand the essence of those stories, we know the importance of surrendering to the master to help to clear all these samskaras. And when samskaras are cleared, like I said a minute ago, liberation or the further growth, spiritual growth is instantaneous. It can happen in this lifetime itself. Hope I was able to clarify that. Yeah. Anything else?
Brother, if time permits, there is one more question. It was in the list of those questions. And it says that, can we practice point A and B more than once?
Okay, now I'll have to give you only my interpretation. Once again, I don't know whether the Aji or the masters have said anything before. My question will be, why not? Okay, we touched upon the prayer, right? We used to do prayer only at bedtime. It was called bedtime prayer. And I must confess, time and again, I would struggle because I would have had a long day at work and come back and there's so many other things going on. By the time I'm ready to crash, I go sit on the bed. I'm half asleep already. And where is the question of attitude? It was like a ritual where I would just say, oh, master, and you know, just going through that. So when Daji actually said this, why don't you do it when you're alert, made a lot of sense to me. So when I do that, and then when I go back, it's a lot easier for me to work with, right? When we were doing cleaning, we do evening cleaning, but when Daji explained to us, why don't you do spot cleaning, right? Spot cleaning is nothing but evening cleaning, but it is a shortened version of it. And it is done the moment you realize something is not right. You know, something is gone. So if we extend that, why don't we do this? That's my only way of looking at it. Although once again, I couldn't find any reference anywhere where he said you can do whenever you want. But I don't see any harm in this. Well, we can try it out and see how it works. I mean, after all, we are only doing meditation. And how is it different from, you know, the suggestion that we give that may all brothers and sisters develop correct thinking, right understanding. It is a suggestion that we are doing. The same way we are now saying all men and women are brothers and sisters, right? Why not? But having said that, doing it at some other time does not absolve us from the responsibility of doing it at the time that is given to prescribe for us. That is important. You do that as well, because that, once again, like I said before, Babuji from his experience has said, do this at this time, do that at that time. Right? So let's do that. But do this in addition to that, I don't see any problem with that. Does that make sense again?
Yes, thank you, brother. Yeah. There's one more, hopefully the last question.
I don't know about the others. It's okay.
So why is it that we meditate on point A but clean point B?
Again, I thought I covered that. Covered that. Right? Where the things, where it is settling down is point B. So you clean that.
Yeah.
Right? And A and B are working together. You know, A and B are not two separate practices. Like if you do A properly, if we consider everybody as brothers and sisters and we are able to really feel that and that is real for us, tell me, is there a need to do point B? Think about it, you know, just take it to that stage, you know, like, why would you have those sensual feelings if we are able to see everyone as brothers and sisters, except your mother and your sister or your wife, you know, I mean, your mother and your sister, for example, would you have that kind of thing? Just try to take it to that level and see what happens. You know, so, we maintain purity of point C. You remember the sign that we said, we put a stop sign there. In the previous one, I did that. Stop, no more. Don't go beyond point C because I'm maintaining the purity of point C. Where comes the question of any of the other points being affected? It cannot happen. But unfortunately, we are not. Our stop sign is not as effective as it should be, isn't it? So we are not able to maintain the purity of point C effectively. And that is why it is slipping through to A and to C and to D. Okay, then we go on to the next stage and maintain those as well. Yeah, so meditating on point A and cleaning of point B are very complementary and they work together. And once again, if you want to look at it the other way, my simplest answer would have been because Babuji told us to do so. That's my easiest way out of it. But I mean, we can think beyond that and we can take it a bit further as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, brother. And that actually answered one more question, which was asked, that when one practices being unmindful of likes and dislikes and is regular in cleaning and meditation, is it still important to keep practicing point A and B cleaning? So you have already answered that question.
Yes, yes. It works that way.
Yeah. All right.
Okay. Any more last questions? No, seriously, I'm okay. Like I said, another 5 minutes is nothing is going to happen, but I'm okay. If you're finished, that's also fine. It's good. I mean, I'm so happy that I was able to interact with you. And yeah. Sister Kalarani?
Yeah, brother. I think what sister said also is a correct way. I mean, it's a point A and B. If we actually do the landing point of point C is to remove our impressions. So if that is achieved, then we don't need to do the A and B.
Yeah.
Z? Correct.
Well, realistically, logically speaking, yes. But unfortunately, we are not able to do that effectively, isn't it?
Yeah. So we still continue to do it.
Of course we have to. Till we get to that stage when, see, the other interesting thing about all this is sometimes we have these likes and dislikes, which we are not even consciously aware of. You know, some of this slip under our conscious radar. Right? And you don't know how it has happened. You know, Daji talks of one simple example where you don't even know how it has happened. You know, like he talks of an example where in a gathering somewhere, you know, people are sitting together. There's a young boy on one side, a young girl on the other side, you know. And the boy is looking at the girl and without any, you know, for whatever reason, she gives a smile. Okay. Now, that girl must have smiled, God knows at what, but in the boy's heart, suddenly there's a flutter. Oh my God, that girl is smiling at me. Now, the girl is not even aware that it is, that she has caused a flutter in this boy's heart. Right? And, but it has triggered something inside and created a like or a dislike or, you know, whatever. A whole stream of feelings which are leading into some kind of samskara, you know, whatever it may be. So that girl didn't even know what she was doing. She is not even aware. You know, so she is responsible for creating that in this boy. And this boy was not even aware, just a smile, and it has triggered something. It has slipped under the radar even before he was aware that something is happening. You know, so many small things that can happen will slip. And therefore, we need to continue. We need to get to that stage when we are perfect, when we don't need to do cleaning. I mean, I wish we all can get to that stage.
Yeah, so there are so many things that we are unaware, we don't realize it. And so that's why we have to continue this A and
that's
B.
Right. Yeah.
Just like the chakras, as Master say, we might be, you think you're on the sixth or seventh chakra, but because of sometimes it happens that these things happen to us unknowingly, and so the cleaning was actually done by Master. Sometimes he does for us on the first chakra or second chakra. So you still have to come down to that point to clean that dislike or impression.
Mm, yeah, it can affect. Thank
you, brother.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Same about guilt that we are talking of. We are not even aware of so many things that are saying, you know, lurking within us, you know, something that we did, you know, years ago, which we didn't mean to. And so, you know, at that, it's sort of gone hidden. But when we do our cleaning, when we are working on ourselves, even that comes up. And then it's an opportunity for us to say, oh my God, I shouldn't have done this. You know, like when I was working as a functionary, I did something which I shouldn't have done. You know, and I know I did a mistake. At that stage, I thought, well, you know, I was so convinced because my ego was so dominant. And it's slipped, it's gone. But now it comes up. Oh, I really wish I had an opportunity to say sorry. You know, I shouldn't have done this to my uncle. And he's no more. I can't even go and tell him sorry. Guilt, you know. So all these sort of things are there. We need to work on it. We need to regret. I mean, yeah, have the remorse and so on. So all these A, B, C, D thing has to be an ongoing thing with a lot of faith, a lot of sincerity, and a lot of conviction. And yes, that'll take us there. And when we, I can't remember who said this, but if we cooperate, he can operate. Yeah, that's all it is. But if we don't cooperate, well, his hands are tied. He will not operate. He cannot operate. Okay. All right. All right. Anything else, Sister Manisha?
No, I think
we are done.
That's all. Thank you so much, brother. Thank Welcome. You for answering Thank all the questions and giving your so much extra time also. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you. Thanks for the Thank opportunity. You. Thank you, Malaysian team, for giving me this chance to talk Thank to you all. Yeah. And like I said, it is an ongoing thing. We all learn. We all learn together and we all grow together. Yeah. Wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you.